What I realized was since January, it became an obsession, very much, very interested in ayahuasca because I'd been researching for so long. And something in me realized that I was creating all that information into kind of more abstractions. I was making it too complicated in my head.
Right.
Because of the intellectualization, and it wasn't some kind of supernatural call, it was just a keen interest and a thirst for kind of experience. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, it's kind of like a self-knowledge seeking, because that's what ayahuasca is often marketed as. It's kind of
quotes like direct experience and the felt presence, immediate experience, they were really standing out to me. Because after looking into so much information, big deal, it just becomes very confusing in the head. Yes. It doesn't sit if you have no experience. So then finally I decided to look up something that would be a safe place, retreat. And I just fell upon Tiruvita through watching videos on the YouTube. Yeah.
And how have you found the environment here? Do you think the environment really helps with the work you do with ayahuasca?
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people from, especially from where I'm from, New York and the States, and living so close to the city, it's kind of a shock because, this is not even the deep jungle at all. It's actually really pleasant. For the first time, I walked barefoot through the whole area. And it's very peaceful. It's very vitalizing. There's a lot of vitality around us because of the sounds, the bird sounds, the insects. And so I think it's a very fitting place to bring out the natural side in each person.
Yeah, because we have a huge disconnect from that, I think, especially in our culture.
Very much. And even things like that, the disconnect and all this separation, it's very strange because it seems like it's such a complex thing. It seems like it's so firmly rooted, but I feel like something in us really just wanted to just pull that out of its roots, that feeling of separateness, because it's not hard at all. Mm-hmm. That's what I started discovering with the ceremonies, is that it's just everything is so much easier than you think, that anyone thinks, coming from that, what I was saying about that intellectualization, that complexification in your head. Experience is so much more, it's just so much more pure than all those abstractions and those flighty thoughts.
Human beings add a lot of stress, personally, and extra layers of complexity.
And things are still exquisitely complex in a different sense, but not in that clouded, almost, there's also a lot of nihilism. And there's also a clouded kind of, that's what I was kind of really trying to treat in me, that sense of artificiality, of my own sense of imagination, other people's.
Do you think that's when the ego is attaching onto it and creating almost an illusion out of it?
Yeah, I think finally understanding what the ego is, all these terms, we think they're just terms, and finally understanding that these symbols do really represent some kind of force or something, some kind of, just something very tangible. At first, it seemed very tangible. But then this disintegration of this feeling of Zane as this collection of desires and feelings, that's what I was feeling the first ceremony. It was very much this kind of disintegration of Zane, who is separate from life. And I mean, I peed my whole life, I pooped my whole life, and still I doubted it, as if it's some kind of matrix thing, and just realizing how connected we all are. And just things like the higher self that we just think about, and things like
What is healing. The higher self to you? You had an experience with that?
The second ceremony was, I felt a profound connection to everyone. And this is what I keep going through, that it's all real, and this connection. When we first started the ceremony, I was very smiley, very happy, just for some reason. And after getting into that state, I kind of knew everybody would be in a similar place. Just, not that I'm defining it, but just that kind of elevated space. So the higher self, I think it's so hard. I don't even want to define it because I feel
it
like
might make it something it's not.
I can just describe the feeling after of just even now just being at a different state of consciousness than the one before. It's just a more peaceful version of the self that you've always been with. And I kept saying, I think, to all of you, even you, that I felt like what I've learned about the illusion was just kind of lifting. And there's always more veils to be lifted. But it's still you, but just a little less clouded.
Yeah, a little less desires. And I know for me, I always get a great sense of relief and relaxation. And
yeah.
That it's okay, it's not, you don't. Higher self doesn't have all these worries that the normal self has.
Just those doubts kind of fade, and you start recognizing. I always used to confuse myself when I just the use of cannabis, marijuana, something for such a young person. he projects. For a young person, you start confusing your dark side as your real side. You start getting scared. I got very scared that this was me, you know, that this doubt and paranoia and people in things. But the really great thing about the higher self is that doubt gets, the love always trumps over it somehow. And what I meant by the veils being lifted off of Maya itself is that just things seemed less malicious to me. Not malicious at all, actually. Hollywood movies and all these conspiracy theories we hear, I just started realizing that these are all parts of the mind that we put up, and these are projections that we kind of push onto these things for our own protection, because in reality our hearts can be very open and we can take in a lot. And it's just, the dark side really is just a defense mechanism, and it's okay that it's me, and it's okay that it comes in and it pulls me away from people, it pulls me away from a certain situation because maybe that's what I need. So yeah, it's just, I can't believe that I'm sitting here right now and, you know, even talking to the camera, which is kind of difficult. I mean, when I take pictures, it's, you know, it's like, how do you like pretend to smile? But now you just
You do often pretend to smile when you take pictures.
They kind of just have this glossed over look. And then just smiling because thinking how this might impact other people, or how it's just letting out this inner smile is kind of easier sometimes. But you shouldn't force it if you don't have to, though.
Yeah.
But, and the one other thing is just the connection to people in general. It's just, I didn't think that you could feel people, you know. I just didn't think you could really... I can't believe that humans are so interconnected.
Right, we're sort of picking up on things.
I think we're the closest counterparts to life, so we can interact the way I'm just kind of spewing sounds at you and you're getting it, and just
the
touch.
The language is just one part of it. You're given so many layers that we're not aware of, we can't see, and it's just you can feel it.
Just profound, it's just on an emotional level, I feel like light is interacting, it feels like it's... you know, I mention a lot of times, like, almost telepathic thing going on sometimes. But yeah, I feel like we're the closest piece of life, and how we've been all put together to be able to interact and feel one another, and, you know. And that's another sense I got, is that we really are important to life. Just the pleasure we can give to an animal, how we scratch its ear, the way we can propagate plants, and just being a conduit for energy itself. And so some ceremonies, it just felt like really doing some great, not work for the world, for Pachamama, but just kind of like really fulfilling my role, you know, as a human mirror or as a human, I don't know, it's kind of hard to explain.
Is it just your attention enough?
The intention before ceremony?
Oh, no, like, your intentions of... when you're channeling something, you're just sending out good intentions.
I think in that moment, when all this information is being channeled through you, I often felt like, especially in the first night when I was receiving information somehow, that life itself would just start getting on its tippy toes, and like the grass and everything was squirming as if they were like, yeah, almost, you almost got it. And I think in that moment, it really is okay to have intention and just let the energy pass through you and become a mirror for the life itself. Just let life see itself. Like, I always thought when I became aware of my cells and even the atoms just through science, material science, it's just that I felt like they were so happy, you know, because it's like acknowledging life. And then I think you must root yourself in a material world. And, you know, like we were talking about the maloka, cutting down on consumption and treating each other properly.
Yeah, it's very important to be aware of that side of life.
So. Yeah, being very grounded. So, yeah, it's just...
Yeah, if we're too much out there, we might not be aware of what we're doing.
We let go of our tangibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the main message, that it's... Miguel said something really nice. He said it really is a choice. You can kind of just choose to be in a better place, and it really is that easy, that people can be loving, and people are loving, and there is a connection between people and life itself. So. Yeah.
Do you think people coming here from our cultures, they would receive... You know, taking ayahuasca, it's an important lesson for them to learn.
Yeah, people might doubt and think it's an easy route. They might. Yeah. I think it's incredibly difficult, and to actually make the intention and drink down every part of it, the taste, and then
it
going through
like
the
it was
release.
Set up so that it was intentionally difficult, so that it shows our willingness.
I feel like that's the dosage thing to me. I feel like the more cups you have, is just your. How much intention you have, and just taking that second glass is like, okay, I'm going to go through that pain of a second intense.
Yeah, because it tastes worse when you're in the ayahuasca. Yeah. You're more in tune with tastes and.
Oh yeah. It's incredibly and you know, it's not easy, because now that you're in a certain position, I think it's the beginning of a spiritual path. Again, and every time you take any psychedelic, I've only tried ayahuasca, but it's just this beginning of this path, and you have to learn how to integrate it now. Rather than, you know, if somebody peddles like, hey, if you sit in my monastery for 50 years, you'll see great visions, just like I've heard about mushrooms. I think that's like the conclusion, you know, it's not the conclusion.
No, it's the beginning.
It's just the beginning.
I think what I found with ayahuasca, it's giving you a direct experience of the mystical experience, so that you can learn from it and sort of learn to, now that you have the experience, you can have it again without it. It's all
there. It's all there. Back to you.